Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Mark Steiner. It's great to have you all with us. It came to light this week because of a report from the Georgetown Law Center on Privacy and Technology that ICE has been using facial recognition technology. That's not too surprising to most of us, but more insidiously, they have mined databases of driver's licenses from across the nation, often without the approval or agreement of those agencies. NPR, CBS, and others have reported these stories, and the hearing in Congress raised some serious questions. This is from Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Amazon actually met with ICE officials over facial recognition system that could identify immigrants. I'd like to submit this to the congressional record.
Without objection.
Do you think it's fair to say that Americans are essentially being spied on and surveilled on a massive scale without their consent or knowledge?
I will say most of the law enforcement agency systems operate on DMV databases or mugshot databases, so information that has been collected by agencies rather than companies.
Do you think that this could exacerbate the already egregious inequalities in our criminal justice system?
It already is.
Now, there's a lot of debate about how reliable facial recognition technology really is. A new report by The Independent showed that misidentification can reach 98% of cases in some cases. It's clear that facial recognition technology is also highly racially biased. It is biased because it's based on white men and their faces. The consequences that people of color will have enormously higher rate of misidentification. And then there's a looming question of who controls the technology and how do you control the government's and private businesses' use of it. What about the future of our privacy, which is the great question of 1984? And we are joined today by someone to help us parse through all of this and figure out what's going on. Evan Greer is a queer activist, singer-songwriter, organizer, parent, speaker, and workshop facilitator based in Boston, writes for many media venues, and is deputy director of Fight for the Future. And Evan, welcome. Good to have you with us here on The Real News.
Thanks so much for having me on.
So let's start with what Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez was talking about when she looked at the question of Amazon and Facebook and their relationship with the government and how they use it, given their technology gurus and Google as well, and the question of invasion of privacy that she was raising. So let's start there, which is where I ended the opening, but I think it's a really critical question about where we go for the future.
We're in a moment where the surveillance state, the kind of dystopian 1984 scenario that you mentioned, is being built in plain sight right in front of our eyes through partnerships between private corporations and the government. And I think that's what's really important to understand here. There's two different entities here that both have a vested interest in spreading this type of incredibly invasive surveillance technology. There's the companies that want to make a ton of money doing it, and then there's government agencies that are just constantly hungry for more power, more data, and more ability to watch all of us all the time.
So talk about what may be dangerous will of this. I mean, you know, we lived in a world where we've had biometric technology for a while, identifying whether a person's face matches a photo ID used by many countries around the globe. But they have all these databases, and state governments and federal governments and others can mine these databases to look, they say, for suspects for crime. But there's something really also dangerous about maintaining these databases. The question is, which you just said, this is hiding in plain sight. So what is it that we do? How do we address the issue of control? How do we address the issue of how this technology is used? Because it's out there, it's not going anywhere, it's here.
So I think this is absolutely the question that we need to be talking about. And it's important that we have the real debate about whether ubiquitous facial recognition surveillance, biometric surveillance, has any role in a free and open society. The tech industry would like to skip ahead. They're proactively calling for quote unquote regulation because they want to skip that debate and get right to how do we roll this out and start making money off of it? Sure, we'll put some restrictions in place to make sure, you know, to assuage people's fears. But let's get to making money off of this. They want to skip the debate about whether this technology should even exist in law enforcement's hands or in the government's hands in the first place. Now, in terms of the dangers, I think it's really important because a lot of the criticism or discussion around facial recognition has focused on the ways that it's inaccurate. And that's important because those inaccuracies, especially in the ways that they're encoded to be racially biased, to have bias against people who are not white men. Those biases have real world consequences. They're going to lead to additional police harassment, incarceration, and potentially even violence against the people that are already being discriminated against by our criminal justice system. So those are real concerns. But I think it's important to recognize that even if this technology worked 100% of the time and was 100% accurate, it would still pose a profound threat to the future of human society and basic rights. None of us want to live in a world where we can be constantly watched by the government everywhere that we go, everyone that we associate with, and complete profiles built of us, of our religious beliefs, political beliefs, and activities. That's a world with no freedom, not just no privacy.
But a couple of quick questions in the short time we have together today, Evan. I mean, one of them has to do, I mean, what I said earlier, this technology is there. I mean, once technology exists, you just can't throw it away and turn it off because it exists. It's part of our world. So the question is, how do you control it? I mean, what has to be done in order for it to be controlled? And that's the issue. And it seems like the Congress isn't really wrestling with this in a deep way in terms of law and of control. You see the agencies coming in, enforcement agencies, not wanting to talk about how they use it because it'll affect their ability to fight crime, they say. There's a lot of issues here. The question is, I'm curious what kind of push and organizing and conversations are you having with those who actually make the laws that can protect us while this technology is in existence?
Absolutely. So there's actually a hearing happening literally right now in the House Homeland Security Committee, where House lawmakers, a number of them, have really been grilling these DHS officials about the ways that the U.S. government is using this. We're in a really important moment right now because there's a tremendous threat. You're absolutely right that this technology is spreading very quickly. But there's also backlash to this technology spreading very quickly. San Francisco just became the first city in the country to ban government use of facial recognition technology. Somerville, Massachusetts just followed suit. A number of other cities are considering similar bans. So this is a situation where there is momentum to limit or ban this technology. And that's why my organization, Fight for the Future, just became one of the first national groups to call for a complete all-out ban on law enforcement and government use of facial recognition surveillance. We launched that campaign yesterday. It got a tremendous amount of press and interest from across the internet. And we do think that Congress is starting to listen. This is one of those rare moments where, I mean, we mentioned AOC at the beginning of the show. AOC and Jim Jordan agree on this. This is something that cuts across the political divide and something that I think everyone can understand. There's something visceral about the idea of having your face scanned and stored in a government database that I think helps inspire people to take action. So I encourage people to contact their members of Congress and their local officials and tell them, don't regulate this technology, ban it. This is on the short list of technologies like biological weapons or nuclear weapons that simply shouldn't be in law enforcement's hands. And Congress has the authority to do that. There's a reason your local police department doesn't have Stinger missiles. Congress can limit what local law enforcement has access to, and they should.
Well, that's a whole conversation itself. How do you ban things that are already in existence? But that, we'll save that for another day, because I think that's a really important question to wrestle with. And what about the issue of how ICE seems to be using this with local databases? There are a lot of states now allow undocumented people to have licenses. And so they're using to tap into these databases to find people to grab and deport and more. And then when you have people like Congressman Brian King from Utah, who said via Twitter, it's not okay that the Utah State DMV officials turned over data to ICE and helped set up a surveillance system. I'll be joining my legislative colleagues to get answers about how this happened. I'm sure our concerns will be bipartisan. So this is part, I think, what kind of unleashed this was this Georgetown report that talked about how ICE is using this technology, which I think is what made this explode in a much larger way. And this is very real. I mean, tapping into DMV databases, not often with the agreement of the local governments.
That's right. And also with absolutely no warrants, no real procedures that protect people's data. I mean, when you go and get your photo taken to get a driver's license, you're not proactively consenting to having your photo stored in a database that can be used for ubiquitous dragnet surveillance. You don't sign anything that says that that's what you're signing up for. And in this case, it's really particularly nauseating because, as you mentioned, ICE was conducting these searches on DMV databases in states where undocumented people are legally allowed to get driver's licenses. So people fought really hard for this basic right because having a driver's license is often essential for being able to participate meaningfully in our society and in the economy and have a job and drop your kids off and all of those basic things that people often do. And people went and signed up for those driver's licenses with the assumption being told that it would be safe for them to do so. And now the federal government is conducting dragnet surveillance of those databases and targeting undocumented people who were doing nothing wrong, who just went and got a driver's license like anyone else. So it really is a profound bait and switch and just illuminates how once this technology continues to spread, as it becomes used more and more frequently by law enforcement, there's so much information out there. There's so many other databases out there, including ones held by private companies. Amazon is collecting a tremendous amount of information through its Ring doorbells. Facebook is, we're all willingly uploading our photos to Facebook. These are huge data sets that absolutely will be exploited and used for surveillance if there aren't limitations put in place. And frankly, if we don't outright prevent our law enforcement agencies from using this type of surveillance.
Yeah, this is almost, you're almost looking at a situation where this is at the turn of the last century, you had this break up the trusts because they were controlling America. This is like a combination of breaking up the trusts and the dangers of government kind of doing as they will with our identities without any control. And those two things are being blended, which is where I think the real danger is, which is one of the reasons you probably, when you said that you're comparing this to biological nuclear weapons, that was what you said, I think, in the interview you had with Common Dreams. And so we're facing this, we're at a precipice. I know you're not prescient, but talk just for a second before we go, where do you think this is going to take us, where the movement to stop this and control this will be going?
I think that this is going to be one of the fundamental issues of our generation. And I think that we need to think about it with the level of seriousness that we think about nuclear and biological weapons. Imagine that we could go back in time and, we were a couple of years before humans ever developed the first weapons of that scale, and we could prevent it. I think most of the folks out there watching would do so. That's the moment that we're in right now with facial recognition. And that's why we need to mobilize and organize to get limitations and bans put in place in as many cities and states as possible, and then leverage that momentum to build bipartisan support for a full-on ban of all government law enforcement use of facial recognition in Congress.
Well, I think that this probably lends itself for us to kind of produce together a very large discussion and debate. It's a huge issue, and there are lots of sides to this, and we need to really get into that. I think that's really important for our future and our freedoms and where we're going. Evan Greer, thank you so much for your work, and thank you for joining us today on The Real News. It's been a pleasure to talk with you. Have a good day.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, Mark, and you too.
And I'm Mark Steiner here for The Real News Network. Thank you all for joining us. Let us know what you think. Take care.